We're so happy to be here celebrating queer storytelling, but there's still a real void in queer content. Our stories are seen as separate, and greenlighting them can also be seen as a generosity even. What comes to mind is we have discussed the movie Bottoms, the lesbian teen fight club film. How, and I think this is a question for all of you, especially, you know, Jules, in thinking about you making films and worrying about if you're making films that are legible, right? How do we break out of this? Can we break out of it? Is it possible? How do we narrow the gap between what other kinds of films get to be and what queer or trans films get to be?
Yeah, I mean, it's something I think about a lot, and I think I make films always primarily for other trans people. Like, that is who I care about caring about my work. Mm-hmm. I mean, I care about some other people too. You know, I mean, only human. I want to be acknowledged and I want people to like my work. But that's my primary audience always. And that's my, like, my what's the North Star? I don't know, whatever, my compass. And I'm sure there are lots of trans people who don't like my work. And part of this is because it's always experimental. Like, I agree very much with Lío. For me, form and content are related. And to me, again, putting trans stories in a cis framework is violent. And it's what I would call like the United Colors of Benetton's approach, which for those people under, I don't know, 30 in the audience, that was like this like United Colors of Benetton. I don't even think Benetton exists anymore, but the ads were always like, we have one Asian person, one black person, one white person, one whatever, was like checklist kind of thing. And it's like, then it's a process of assimilation. And it's putting black folks into white containers, right? And it's like just swapping out diversity for diversity's sake. So for me, a trans story is one that is complex, nuanced, and maybe doesn't make sense. I'm putting that in strong air quotes. So I would lean into what like the scholar Jack Halberstam would say, like, bewilderment is a strategy for trans liberation. Like, I don't want you to walk away from my film thinking you understand everything. Because thinking you understand everything, and people bring this expectation to documentary in particular, because we think documentaries are out to educate us. So someone goes and watches a film about trans people, they think they're gonna walk out knowing what trans people are. As if one film could do that. But that's how we relate to film, I think, especially documentary. And so I'm always trying to push against that and trying to push against, like, you think you know what this is about, but you actually don't. Mm-hmm. And that is what I want, because that pushes against this Western notion of mastery. Trintamin Ha talks about speaking nearby. And I love that, because if we think about it spatially, it's not one where I'm standing in your place. I'm next to you. It's a space of affinity and alliance, and it allows us both to have our full autonomy and all our alterity, our otherness, right? You get to be other to me, and other doesn't have to be bad. Okay, sorry, I feel like I'm going on a screed.
We're with you.
I'm gonna stop there, but.
We liked it, yeah.
I actually have something to sort of add to that, because where you ended was, you know, I'm allowed to be other and alongside you at the same time. And I think that so many trans, queer, non-white, like, people in Hollywood are being asked to talk about themselves in this way where they're like, I'm in this box, this is the thing I represent. And, you know, even with Bottoms, it's like, let's give the lesbians an opportunity to be funny and have a buddy comedy. And it's all about the fact that it's a lesbian buddy comedy, whereas Superbad, its brother film, is just, it's not like they said, oh, it's these two, I don't even know how to describe those two guys. They're just guys because they're the default, right? White cis men are the default. They don't need to be legible or described or identified. And so this dialectic of I have to sort of identify myself to exist in this construct, I think, comes from this paradigm in the US, which it makes people feel like, oh, this is a cause. If I'm not trans, this is a cause I have to care about to be a good person, rather than
it's a separation.
Exactly. Yeah. This mode of separation as the default, as the invisible organizing principle in our society socially, that separates us at this like fundamental paradigm where it's like, oh, I'm gonna be a compassionate, empathetic person and therefore care about this cause, not I'm gonna become critical and question the ideology that pushes separation at all. Who is benefiting from separation? Do you know what I mean? Like that paradigm at the core of it is the thing that I'm like, can we get some of these expert storytellers some serious resources and do like a think tank like mode where we're doing covert culture shifting to move people away from the paradigm of separation and into one of like collective resistance, you know?
I think you have a real point there, Lío. I do. I think of it as like this institutional covert censorship operation. I mean, even no shade, but like there's a plethora of queer films premiering at Sundance and they are labeled as such. And I sometimes worry that the separation and being branded as niche prevents the people who really need to be transformed by these stories from even engaging with them in the first place. And I also think about, you know, especially as we, you know, these stories are seeking funding to be distributed out of independent film spaces, right? Like, really great that a lot of independent films will touch on queer narratives, but how do we get that big box office money?
I think it happens through the immense amount of work of all the organizers that are existing and came before us. But it's like, I feel like I see it happening very slowly. We have Good Grief on Netflix by Dan Levy, who's a gay man. Yeah. Really, I love him, huge fan. And, you know, it's not being marketed as a gay film about grief. It's being marketed as a film about grief. And that is because a white cis gay man is sort of at the top of the social hierarchy of queerness. Right. And so then eventually that will trickle down to the point where Mutt, for example, doesn't have to be marketed as a trans coming of age story. It can be marketed as a coming of age story about a young person living in New York City, which many people can respond to. That being said, we're still in this paradigm of sort of one thing at a time, trying to get to the place where we get to Good Grief instead of going through the back door